you ain't been through. You can't counsel me if you ain't been through. We must all go through. This is the story of Jonah. God shows up in chapter 1. He says, Jonah, here's your assignment. I want you to head due east to Nineveh. Jonah says, thanks, but no thanks. He heads due west to Tarshish. God then puts on his running shoes, and he comes after Jonah. And we learn, man, that grace is not letting you do you. Grace is not God watching you wallow in sin and not coming after you, but grace is coming after you and coming after you and coming after you. That's what God does in chapter 1. He sends the storm, and he oversees the lots, and he hurls them into a sea, and he points the fish. And finally, in chapter 2, Jonah, having gone through the interruption, is now in rehab. He's dealing with his idols, with his issues. Painful, it's lonely. Now in chapter 3, watch it, look at verse 1. And I'm hoping I can get out of verse 1 today. We may not even get out of verse 1. The Bible says, don't miss it, the word of the Lord came to Jonah, don't miss it, a second time. Let me stop right there. God could have looked at Jonah when Jonah ran away in chapter 1. He could have said, that's okay, Jonah. That's fine. You do you. I'll find somebody else. If you check my resume, God could say, I've used bushes. I've used donkeys. The sun does not rise and set on you, Jonah. I'll just find somebody or something else. God could have said, you had your chance, I'm moving on, you failed, you sinned, I'm done with you. But then in chapter 3, verse 1, it says that the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Anybody here ever had God come to them a second time? And a fifth, and a 17th, and a 38th. I'm here to tell you that what this church is about, this church is not about legalism. This church is not about put on your dancing shoes and perform for God. And if you don't perform, you know, God will put you on the bench. No, we serve a second time God. We serve a 30th time God. We serve a God of another chance and another chance and another chance. Watch this now. So that what this text begins with, it begins on a note of God having interrupted God. Watch it now. But we learn that God's interruptions are not his eruptions. When God interrupts us, it is not his eruptions. In other words, God interrupting us is not an outburst of anger from a petulant, punitive God. The very fact that God comes after Jonah again and again and again and gives him another shot shows us, watch it now, the patience of God. So that what we see in verse 1 is not a God of wrath. It's not a God of condemnation. It is a patient God. I want you to write down Exodus chapter 34, and I want to just encourage you, if you have some time this week, just sit and marinate in Exodus chapter 34. In Exodus chapter 34, God and his servant Moses is having a conversation, and God is not happy with what he sees. He has just delivered his people from bondage in Egypt. He has opened up the Red Sea miraculously. They have walked through on dry ground. He then closes up that Red Sea on their pursuers, the Egyptians. He has miraculously set them free. And how do they thank him? They wait until Moses goes up Mount Sinai to have a talk with God. And then at the base of that mountain, they worship another god. And God is shaking his head going, now ain't this something? I deliver you and I rescue you and you don't worship somebody else. So God and Moses have this exchange. God says, Moses, I'm going to wipe everybody out. I'm going to start over with you. Moses, I can't do that. You made a promise. Moses then comes back to God and they have this back and forth. And all of a sudden, Moses out of the blue says to God, show me your glory. God says to Moses, no one can see my face and live. But here's what I'm going to do for you, Moses. I'm going to hide you in the cleft of a rock. And then I'm going to pass by. I'm going to make all my goodness, he says, pass by. I'm going to let you see not my face, but my exhaust. So here's Moses, 80-something years of age, hiding in the cleft of a rock, and God marches past Moses. Now the question on the table is, Moses, what did you see when God passed by? Look at it with me on the screen, Exodus 34, verses 6 through 7. Watch it. The Lord passed before him and proclaimed, the Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. I'll read it again. The Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin. Question, Moses, what did you see when God walked by? Answer, I saw the patience of God. Now watch this. If you read your Bible, that statement in Exodus 34, verses 6 through 7, watch it now, is stated 7 times in the Old Testament verbatim. 7, the number for completion. It is as if God is saying to all of the Old Testament authors, I want you to continually write down this statement of who I am. Why? Because I want to seal it in the minds of the readers forever. I am patient. So let me read not all 7 of them, 3 of them. Look at Nehemiah 9, verse 17 on the screen. Says they refused to obey and were not mindful of the wonders that you performed among them, but they stiffened their neck and appointed a leader to return to their slavery and sin. In other words, God's people have sinned, they have messed up, they have blown it, but watch it, but you are a God ready to forgive, hear it, gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Psalm 103, verse 8, the Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. Joel chapter 2, verse 13 says, return to the Lord your God. Why? For he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and he relents over disaster. Now, look in your Bibles, Jonah chapter 4, verse 2. It says, and he prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said when I was yet in my country? This is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish. Why? For I knew that you are gracious God, merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, and relenting from disaster. Is this sinking in? God is patient. He's patient with his people. The idea of the word patience in the Greek, it is the Greek word makrothumos. It is a compound word. Macro meaning long or large, and thumos, from which we get the English word thermometer. It's an instrument we use to measure heat. It means anger. So literally, makrothumos means long to anger. How is a person's patience tried? You only try a person's patience in your sin. In other words, if you really want to see the patience of God, God's patience is clearly seen, not when you dot all your I's and cross all your T's. It is only seen when you fall and fall and fall and fall, and God never leaves. God is patient. Someone needs to hear that word today. But God is patient with me. Can you just take your hand and put it over your heart and say these words with me?
Yeah.
God is patient with me. Now, I really want you to get this word. Say it again. God is patient with me. For those of us who are parents, remember our kids when they were just learning how to walk? Right? We get so excited, man. They're wobbling.
those chubby ankles. And we're like, come to daddy, come to daddy. Corey, Corey, get the camera, we'll just snap the picture, man. We're gonna tweet this out, Instagram it. Come to daddy, come to daddy. They take a step, and they take another step, bam. At no point do you go, idiot. Dummy. Now what you do is you rush in. You pick them up. You hold them. You say, it's okay, put it back down. Let's try it again. Come on. Bam! Well, think about when you taught your kids to ride a bike. You were so convinced they were gonna blow it, you had them put on the helmet, elbow pads, knee pads. You gave all the instruction in the world, knowing they were going to fall. And when they fell, you did not rush in condemnation. How much more so God? Proverbs 24 says, though a righteous man falls seven times, he gets back up again. What makes him righteous? Even though he falls, he gets back up. But how does he get back up? The patience and grace of God. Your sin does not surprise God. God is omniscient. He's all-knowing. Before he even saved you, he knew all the times you would fail him. But would you just think about that? Your fornication the other night did not surprise him. There is nothing we do in our lives that occurs to God. Your porn addiction does not throw him off. Your gossipy tongue, your divisive spirit, your slander, your greed, your slothfulness, bam, 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 does not cause him to rush in condemnation. Slow to anger. God is patient with me. Jonah falls. The word of the Lord comes to him a second time. So that, hear it, we learn that the patience of God is always tethered to his purpose. God is patient with Jonah because God does not just care about those people down the street, around the corner. He also cares about his prophet. So that what we learned in the first week is true, that God doesn't just use people to accomplish tasks, he also uses tasks to accomplish people. That there is a work God is doing, not just in the people of Nineveh, but he wants to also do it in his prophet. But in order to do that work in his prophet, he has to be patient. So now he comes to Jonah, a second time the text says, and he gives Jonah his assignment. And what we've been learning, what we've been discovering is, for all of us in this room, all of us leasing time on God's green earth, there's a call of God on your life. There's an assignment on your life. And God's call and God's assignment is so much more than making money. It is so much more than sending your kids to a certain kind of school. It's so much more than having kids. He has a call and he has an assignment on your life that goes past jobs and paychecks and houses and zip codes. You were created by God to give God glory. Now the question on the table is, how do I know what God's assignment is for my life? This text helps us. God comes to Jonah. He says, I've been patient with you. Coming back to you a second time. And here's your assignment. I want you, again, make your way east